Lorsque l'on se préoccupe de gestion de la biodiversité,
when thinking about how to manage biodiversity, we need to understand why we want to preserve and conserve biodiversity. There are three answers, possible answers. The first possible answer is the intrinsic value we attribute to biodiversity. We attribute a given value to biodiversity. It contributes to the history of evolution that we've been part of for more than 2 billion years. Therefore, it goes further than our empathy for other species. The second type of answer is the evolutionary potential of biodiversity. Biodiversity has evolved over the last 2 billion years. Most documented species have now disappeared, and biodiversity has shown in the past that it had the capacity to adjust to global changes, environmental changes, and global changes that we as human beings are fostering. If we want biodiversity to be able to react to the changes, it has to keep its evolutionary potential. The second type of answer is combined with the first type of answer. We cannot maintain biodiversity if we don't maintain the evolutionary potential. The third answer corresponds to the ecosystem's functionalities, which are absolutely essential for human societies. The species we domesticate, we use, the ecosystems we exploit must be able to operate, and their good operation depends on the conservation of biodiversity. So, once we identify the reasons for which we want to conserve biodiversity, we need to find out what kind of compartment we are interested in. And there are several compartments that we want to preserve. There are three main compartments. The first type of compartment is what we call, roughly,
c'est le compartiment qui est le mieux connu
endangered species. It's the best known compartment of biodiversity. There are a number of species which are threatened, and if we don't do something about it, they will disappear very quickly, and the tiger is a very good example.
Vis-à-vis de ces espèces
menacées, now, for these endangered species, we need to develop what we call conservational ecology and restoration ecology. One of the main actions consists in creating protected spaces, which may represent about 10 to 20% of the Earth area, where we're going to take actions controlling human activities. And we will come back to this kind of activity that will be controlled, bearing in mind that the network of protected spaces is unfortunately quite insufficient nowadays. Only about 20% of the endangered species are adequately defended and represented in the network of protected areas. But beyond endangered species, we also have another very important compartment in biodiversity, what we call ordinary biodiversity. Ordinary biodiversity is what we have all around us. We will discuss its definition and the stakes of ordinary biodiversity. Let us say just now, in this general presentation, that ordinary biodiversity is the one we find in 80% of our ecosystems, the ecosystems that are neither protected spaces or remarkable spaces where we find remarkable biodiversity, nor towns and villages, places where man is intensely present. I'm talking about the countryside, the forest, the ocean, and in this compartment of biodiversity lies the future of biodiversity, of its evolutionary potential and its functionalities. The third compartment, which we will not focus on during this week, regards domesticated species, which obviously are essential for us, but it's about management of fishing and fisheries, agronomy, forestry, anything that has to do with species that are intensely exploited. Behind all of these ecosystems, we find another compartment, which is just as important, spaces which are inhabited by human beings, towns and villages with a high density of population. In these spaces, biodiversity is only marginally represented, although we are trying to green up our towns. We are finally understanding that biodiversity plays an important role in our towns and improves our quality of life. But ecosystems such as towns and villages are important for different reasons. Human being consumption and biodiversity policies depend very much on town dwellers. Very soon, the majority of people will be living in town. Very soon, 80% of people will be living in town, in urban areas. And town dwellers, through their consumption, they consume animal proteins or products coming from the agriculture or the food industry, will determine the pressure bearing down on ecosystems and the ordinary biodiversity as well as protected spaces. We have a certain way of life, and the way we think our relationship with biodiversity will determine a very important stake for the future of biodiversity. These three topics will be discussed: the management of protected spaces, the management of ordinary biodiversity, and the management of our urban way of life in such a way that this way of life may be consistent with the biodiversity. We need to remember that there are three different compartments where biodiversity is absolutely essential, and we should not disregard any of those stakes. Now, we are looking at ecosystems, but they're not the same depending on whether we're talking about a tropical region with very few inhabitants or a large town in northern hemisphere countries or an intensive agricultural landscape. We will understand that the biodiversity stakes are not the same in all three types of ecosystems. There will be different biodiversity stakes, but they are just as important as the others.